Make the right choice today and choose Jesus.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. This is the Christian Family and Choice Radio 92.9 FM. Your life, your salvation, your choice, inviting you to get something to write with and something to write on. Let us pray.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, we thank you on tonight. Once again, Father God, we just thank you. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you, Father. We love you on tonight, Father God, but we thank you most of all for your son, Jesus, a man that knew no sin, but yet and still he died for us, Father, and we thank you. And Father, once again, we take nothing for granted, Lord God. We thank you for all those who are out there on the internet, Lord God, the phone lines, and for every means, Father God, that they have to listen to you, Father. We thank you for your word, which is quick, powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Your word always goes out to do what is accomplished, Lord God, and your word never returns void, Father, and we thank you. We thank you for 92.9, Father God, that you have made a way that your people will not be destroyed for a lack of knowledge, Lord God. We just thank you, Father God, for what you're doing here on this station, Lord God. We just thank you, Father. We love you on tonight, Lord God. And Father, on tonight, Lord God, we thank you for the pastor. We thank you for the wisdom, the knowledge, and the revelation that you have given him, Father God, to minister onto your people, the true living word, Father God. We thank you for the word of God because it brings us life and life more abundantly, Father. We thank you on tonight. We magnify you on tonight. We glorify you on tonight in no other name but in Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen and amen.
Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. It is a wonderful opportunity and privilege to be here to lift up the name of Jesus, a name that's above every name. Of that name, every knee must bow, beings in heaven, beings on earth and beings under the earth, and every tongue must confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. We look at the Apostle Paul, who wrote most of the New Covenant. He said everything he got together by revelation of Jesus Christ. And he said the early church, in the book of Acts, said the early church searched the scriptures out daily to see if these things were so. So we're searching the scriptures out daily. Paul said to Timothy, from a child that was known the Holy Scriptures, able to make thee wise, but to tell Timothy to study, to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of God. So you could wrongly divide the word of God. I want to continue where we left off earlier this week, looking at a mini series that we entitled With Persecution. Let's go to the book of Mark. M-A-R-K is Mark. Mark chapter 10, and see what God is saying to us in his holy written precious words. Mark chapter 10, a rich young ruler came to Jesus and ask him, what must he do to get eternal life? Jesus gave him some instruction, what you have to do. And after they give them the instruction, he didn't want to do it, not for eternal life. And then Peter picked up part of that conversation. We want to pick up that conversation at the 28th verse of Mark chapter 10, with persecution. Mark chapter 10, look at the 28th verse. Then Peter began to say unto him, lo, we have left all and followed thee. Jesus answered and said, verily I say unto you, that there is no man that hath left house, or brethren, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my sake and for the gospel, but he shall receive 100-fold now in this time, houses, brethren, sisters, mothers, children, lands, with persecution, and the world to come eternal life. Many that are first shall be last, and the last shall be first. We have to read those verses again. We're using those few verses at the 12 inches to make our foot, looking at this series that we titled Persecution. What it is to be persecuted, to trouble, to annoy constantly, to afflict or to harass constantly, to injure or to distress, cause distress, sometimes because of your race, religion, or your politics, sometimes for those reasons, but to persecute. Look at those verses again on Mark chapter 10, the 28th verse. Then Peter began to say unto him, lo, we have left all and followed thee. Jesus answered and said, verily I say unto you, that there is no man that have left house, brethren, sisters, father, mother, wife, children, or lands for my sake and for the gospel, but he shall receive 100-fold now in this time, houses, brethren, sisters, mothers, children, and lands with persecution, and the world to come eternal life. Many that are first shall be last. Hallelujah. Let's go back to the book of Genesis and see what God is saying to us with persecution. Genesis chapter 4, get something to write with and something to write on. Genesis chapter 4, that which was, that which is, that which shall be done is that which is done. There's nothing new under the sun. Genesis chapter 4, and let's go way back there and see with persecution. Genesis chapter 4. And let's begin with verse 1. Genesis chapter 4 and verse 1, with persecution. Adam knew Eve his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I've gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain bought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. Abel also bought of the firstling of the flock, and the fat thereof, and the Lord had respect unto Abel and his offering, but unto Cain and his offering he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said unto Cain, Why art thou wroth? Why is thy countenance fallen? If thou dost well, shalt not thou be accepted? If dost not well, sin lieth at thy door, and unto thee shall be thy desire, and thou shalt root of him. Cain talked with Abel his brother, and it came to pass, when they were in the field, that Cain rose up against Abel and his brother, and slew him. And the Lord said unto Cain, Where is thy brother Abel? And he said, I know not. Am I my brother keeper? And he said, What is it that thou hast done? The voice of thy brother blood cried unto thee from the wood. Now thou art cursed from the earth, from the open of the mouth to receive thy brother blood, and from thy hands. And when thou tillest the ground, it shall not henceforth yield unto thee the strength. A fugitive and a vagabond now shall be in the earth. And Cain said unto the Lord, My punishment is greater than it can bear. So here you see, it start way back then with persecution. Here you have Abel being blessed, but he did the right thing, and Cain didn't do the right thing. So you see, those who are blessed are being persecuted, and God went to him personally and talked to him. Why are you wroth? If you do what Abel do, you'll be blessed like him. If you bring your tithes and offering, and there are people are something else. They don't want to come to church, they don't want to read the Bible, they don't want to pay their tithes, they don't want to live right. And when you get blessed, they're being envious of you being blessed. So here is Abel doing his part, and God going personally to Cain and say, Why are you wroth? If you do what Abel do, you'll be blessed. Just at him. Let's read those verses again. With persecution. Now he did everything that he asked to do, and God went in person, Almighty God went in person and said, Why not? If you do what Abel do, you'll be blessed. Look at those verses again. Go back to verse 1. Adam knew Eve his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I've gotten a man from the Lord. And she bare again his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain bought the fruit of the ground, an offering unto the Lord. Abel, he also bought the firstling of his flock, the fat thereof, and the Lord had respect unto Abel and his offering, but unto Cain and his offering he had not respect, and Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. You see, he take his time, give God the best he give to God. First day of the week, give it to God. The first hour of the day, give it to God. The first of your salary, first 10% of your salary, give it to God. The first, look at it, go back up to verse 4. Abel also bought of the firstling of his flock, the fat thereof, the best, and the Lord had respect unto Abel and his offering, but unto Cain and his offering he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, not just wroth, but very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord sent him unto Cain, Why art thou wroth? Why is thy countenance fallen? If thou dost well, he's telling him what to do. Do this, pay your tithe, study your Bible, study to show yourself approved. Do what he said, be loving one to another. Study, pay your tithes, be in church, don't forsake it. Do these things. You do these things, you'll be blessed. Look at verse 6. And the Lord said unto Cain, Why art thou wroth? Why is thy countenance fallen? If dost thou well, shalt not thou be accepted? If dost not well, sin lieth at thy door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. And Cain talked with Abel his brother, and it came to pass, you see, brother is blessed, Abel is blessed. And it's the same thing today. That which was is that which is, that which shall be done is that which is done. And nothing new under the sun. He did the best, and he get blessed with, and he been persecuted because he's been blessed. Can you see that? Amen, amen, and amen. Look at something here in 1 John chapter 3. Let's go way back down to the back of the Bible, 1 John chapter 3. And let's sort of put some icing on that cake that we just read there, 1 John chapter 3. Look at the 12th verse. Look at the 12th verse. 1 John chapter 3. Look at the 12th verse. With persecution, you get all the blessing, prosper. And we saw with Isaac went into Gerar, and he sowed in that land and received the same year 100-fold. And the Philistine envied him. All they had to do is to sow. Yeah, Cain and Abel. God tell Cain, you could do just what Abel do and you'll be blessed, but you don't want to do it. Now you do it, you get blessed, and when you get blessed, give it to me. I'll pay the price. You just stay home, look at worldly TV, don't want to read your Bible, don't want to come to church, I want to live off your blessing like a spiritual parasite. No, you do these things. 1 John chapter 3, look at verse 12. Not as Cain, who is of the wicked one, and slew his brother, wherefore he slew him because his own works was evil and his brethren was righteous. Well, you see, God is a good God. God is not an evil God. So you see, if you're not doing what God asks you to do, you get in Satan territory. You get into disobedience, and disobedience is sin, like stubbornness and idolatry. You see, God ain't to do. Look at that verse. Not as Cain, who is of the wicked one. You see, if he listened to God and just do what Abel said to do, he wouldn't be of the wicked one. But you see, once you're not paying your tithes, the Bible says you're cursed.
With a curse.
Nothing would work for you. You're operating under a curse. Money will be very difficult to come because you're not getting money. You'll do all kind of unscrupulous thing to get money. You see, you're cursed. You operate under a curse. You see, he's of the wicked one. Look at this. Who was of the wicked one and slew his brother. You see, the wicked one will do that. The thief come not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Wherefore he slew him because his works were evil and his brother own was righteous. Go back to Genesis chapter 12. Hallelujah. You'll be persecuted because you've been blessed. Yeah, just be blessed. Genesis chapter 12. And look at Abraham and his wife Sarah. Watch these things, get something to write with and something to write on. With persecution. With persecution, God bless you because you pay your tithes. He said, I'll open you the windows of heaven and pour you out, bless me, no room to receive it. You don't pay your tithes, the Bible says you are cursed with a curse. Genesis chapter 12, and look at this. Watch this. With persecution. Pick it up at the 10th verse. Genesis chapter 12. Look at the 10th verse. You could read all of it, but let's pick it up at the 10th verse. And there was a famine in the land, and Abram went down to Egypt and sojourned there, and the famine was grievous in the land. And it came to pass, when he was come near to enter into Egypt, he said unto Sarah his wife, Behold, I now know that thou art a fair woman to look upon. In other words, you're very pretty, very attractive woman. Look at verse 12. Therefore it shall come to pass, when the Egyptians shall see thee, they shall say that this is thy wife, and they shall kill me and save thee alive. So you see, because of his pretty attractive wife, he'll be killed. He'll be persecuted because of your wife. You know people like that? Look at that. Look at that. Go back to the 11th verse. And it came to pass when they were coming into Egypt. Egypt is a type of the world. Go into the world. They shall say unto Sarah, his wife, Behold, I know that thou art a fair woman to look upon. Therefore, it shall come to pass when the Egyptians shall see thee, they shall say, This is his wife, and they shall kill me, but they will save thee alive. So I say unto thee, thou art my sister, it may be well with me for thy sake, and as my soul shall live because of thee. So you see, because of his wife, they'll kill you. You have something, somebody want what you have. You see, that's what they call covetousness. You want something somebody have, you want it that, but you'll do anything to get it. So because of his attractive wife, the Egyptian will kill him to get his wife. Mm. Command him to the wife. This is in Egypt. Now when he went down to the Philistine, the same thing with Abimelech. You see Sarah there again. Sarah was some kind of person. Let's take a little side. Sarah was some kind of person. Sarah was close to 90 years here when she went down to the Philistine. Here in Egypt, she was a bit younger, about 80 years or so. But now they went down into the Philistine, and again they commended her towards to Abimelech the king. And he saw Sarah, and they wanted Sarah, and they get Sarah there, and God have to deal with Abimelech to put a stop to it, or else he will kill Abraham to take his wife. So here in Egypt, Pharaoh wants Sarah, and here he goes down to the Philistine, Abimelech wants Sarah. So Sarah was some kind of, and the Bible says, you women, you are daughters of Sarah. You are daughters of Sarah. Can you see that? Amen. So you'll be persecuted because of your wife. You'll be persecuted because God bless you with persecution. Hallelujah. Genesis chapter 27. Let's go there. Genesis chapter 27. We're going way back in the old covenant. That which was is that which is. That which shall be done is that which is done. Is nothing new under the sun. Genesis chapter 27. And let's pick up a few verses and see something just looking with persecution. Looking at different pictures with persecution. And here, Isaac had two sons, Esau and Jacob. Esau is the eldest boy, and he's getting ready to leave the land that they live in. So he called his eldest son, and he said, well, before I die, go make me some special meal that you always make me so I can bless before I leave. So his wife Rebecca heard it, and she went and get her favorite son, which is Jacob, and say, well, we'll use some subtlety, and you're going to get the blessing instead of it. But nevertheless, you could be persecuted because you are blessed. When your father blessed, God blessed us with all spiritual blessing, heavenly places in Christ, we are blessed. And because you are blessed, you are persecuted. Now he get it by subtlety, but nevertheless, he's blessed. So let's pick up part of the story. You need to read the whole story, but let's pick up part of the story in Genesis chapter 27. Isaac getting ready to leave the land of the living. He died 180 years when he leave the land living. So he tells his elder son he wants a blessing because the blessing will pass from the elder son and then from generation to generation. And so, look at it, Genesis chapter 27. Look at the 30th verse. And it came to pass as soon as Isaac had made an end of blessing Jacob, and Jacob was scarce gone out from his presence of Isaac, his father, that Esau, his brother, came in from hunting. He sent Esau to go and get him meat and come and break it. So he come in by subtlety and he get a blessing. And look at that, verse 31. He also had made a savory meat and brought it on to his father and said unto his father, well, let my father now rise and eat the son venison that he had made and bless me. His father said unto him, who art thou? He said, I am thy son, thy firstborn. And Isaac trembled exceedingly because the brother came in and take the blessing, and he was angry. Look at verse 83. And Isaac trembled very exceedingly and said, who art thou? Who? And he said, that I have taken the venison and brought it to me, and I have eaten on before thee and came and blessed him, and he shall be blessed. And when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with a great and exceedingly bitter cry and said unto his father, bless me, even me, my father. And the father said, thy brother came with subtlety, and I'll take away the blessing. So he got the blessing. And there's nothing to do. A facet of revelation there, the gifts and calling of God without repentance. God bless him, and he can't take it back. So he cried to the father, please bless me, give me another blessing. Can't do it. But look at it, because of his best. Go down to verse 41. Look at verse 41. With persecution. Now your father blessed him, and well, we are blessed. You could be living in a household, you are a Christian, an informed Christian. God bless you with all spiritual blessings in every place. And the rest of your family in the house, they're not blessed. They're cursed, because if they're not born again, Satan is the spiritual father, and he come not but for to steal, to kill, and destroy. If you receive Christ and you in that household, you are being blessed. The thief come not but for to steal, to kill, and destroy. God come that you may have life and have it more. So you could be right in there and you've been blessed. Everything just working for you, smooth like glass. And your brothers and sisters right there not being blessed. Look at what he says. Look at verse 41. Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing wherewith his father had blessed him. And Esau said in his heart, the days of the mourning of my father are at hand, and when I will slay my brother Jacob. You see, so he said, I'm going to keep it here in my heart, and when the minute my father die, I'm going to kill him. You see, that's a terrible way to live. You know, the father live, think about this. There are people who are listening out there and viewing through the internet or whatever way you're communicating with the station, have things that they're holding in their heart from 10 cents over young, and they wouldn't leave it. Let me tell you something. You're not going anywhere if you don't give it up. You're not going anywhere. Think about it. When Isaac had these twins, he was 60 years old. He met Rebecca when he was 40 years old. When he was 60 years, he had the twin. Isaac died at 180 years. These two twins was 120 years when he died. So think about it. Think about it. At 120 years, imagine you holding that poison there for until you become 120 years. He said, look at verse 41. Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing where his father had blessed him. And Esau said in his heart, the days of my father mourning are at hand. Then will I slay my brother Jacob. So he said, in other words, the minute my father died, I'm going to kill him. You see, he'd had to wait a long time to kill him. So if he's going to hold that poison inside him, he have to keep it there for that length of time, because the father died 180 and they was 120 years old when he died. Think about it, being persecuted because being blessed. Genesis 37. And look at Joseph. With persecution, you get the blessing, but you're going to be persecuted. You have a pretty wife, you're going to be persecuted for your wife. You pay your tithes and God open the windows of heaven and bless you, you're going to be persecuted. He's going to bless you and not curse you. The Philistine envy Isaac because of the blessing that God blessed him. Everybody went down to Egypt. He said, you stay right here in Gerar. I'm going to show you that I'm God right here. I don't have to go in Egypt to be God. I don't have to go anywhere to be God. I'll be God right here. You sow into this land and you receive 100-fold, and the Philistine envied him with persecution. Hallelujah. Genesis 37. All this is life. I'm a witness to this. This is his life. Look at families and friends. This is life. He must be speak, present tense. Hallelujah. Genesis 37. Look at this. Pick it up at verse 1. And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generation of Jacob, Joseph being 17 years old when feeding his father's flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhan, with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wife. And Joseph brought his father the evil report. And Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many color. When his brethren saw that their father loved him more than their old brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. And Joseph dreamed a dream and told it unto his brethren, and they hated him yet more. So they have two reasons to hate him, because he dreamed a dream and because his father loved him. But you see, they bring the evil report, so they was doing wrong, just like Cain and Abel. It's just like Cain and Abel. You see, Abel did right, so he been blessed, and Cain did wrong, he been cursed. So here he bring all the evil report. Let's read those verses again. With persecution, because your father, your mother love you more than them. Well, sometimes you're doing what's right, and they're not doing what's right. They're not flying right. So they bless you because if you're doing wrong and they love you for doing wrong, they'll be aiding and abetting your spiritual crime. You do right, because the same thing God said, this is same thing all the time. Same thing God said to Cain. He said, if you do right, you'll be blessed. But if you do wrong, sin light at your door. Well, you have family, they don't want to do anything, don't want to go and get an education, don't want to get a life together, don't want to get married, don't want to do anything, just live like children of the devil. You would want to do the right thing and being blessed, and they'd be envious of you. So here he living, let me read this again. With persecution, go back up to verse 1. And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. And these are the generation of Jacob, Joseph being 17 years old, feeding his father flock, and his brethren with the lad, with the sons of Bilhan, with the sons of Zilpah, and his father's wife. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. You see, they're not doing right. They're not doing right. The evil report. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age, and made him a coat of many color. When his brethren saw that their father loved him more than his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. Verse 5, Joseph dreamed a dream and told it unto his brethren, and they hated him yet more because he dreamed a dream. Go down to verse 11. Read the whole story, but look at verse 11. With persecution. You're going to get it. Get your father love. You get the blessing of your father. With persecution, we see him too. Look at verse 11. And his brethren envied him, but his father observed his saying. His brethren envy him. Well, why, he did right. You do the right thing, you'll be blessed. You do the wrong thing, you'll be cursed. You get under Satan territory. The thief come not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Hallelujah. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 30. See another picture. With persecution, 22 minutes after the first hour, get something to write with and something to write on. This is the Christian Family and Choice Radio, 92.9 FM, Your Life, Your Salvation, Your Choice. Telephone number to church, 347-533-4271. Telephone number to studio, 347-663-8638. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Look at this. With persecution. And you look at this, parallel your life with this, and you see this picture play out all the time. I could say amen to that 100 times. Persecution, trouble, annoyed, constantly, to afflict or to harass, to cause injury or distress. Another thing, because of your race, because of your religion, because of your politics, because of your blessing that God bless you with. Yeah, persecution. Look at this here in Genesis chapter 30. Look at the 43rd verse. Put your finger in the 43rd verse. Genesis chapter 30. Look at the 43rd verse. The man increased exceedingly and had much cattle, maid servants, men servants, camel and asses. Now the man they talk about here is Jacob. Now they tell you this is the ending, but we're going back to the beginning. Watch this. Look at that verse again. Look at that verse. Genesis 30. Look at the 43rd verse. The man increased exceedingly and had much cattle, maid servants, man servant, camel and ass. If you read the story, when he went to Laban's house, he was flat broke. Laban gave him a job. And he said, "You don't want to work for me for naught." He had two daughters, Rachel and Leah. Leah is the elder daughter. And he said, "Well, I'll work 7 years to get Rachel." So he worked 7 years to get Rachel. And when he said 7 years, they would give him Leah. So he had to work another 7 years to get Rachel. So he worked 14 years for his two daughters. But look at here, they said the man increased exceedingly and had much cattle, maidservant, menservant, camel and asses. We're looking at with persecution. Go over to chapter 31. Go over to the next chapter. Watch this. With persecution. I could say amen to this 100 times. Amen, 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 and amen. Look at this. Genesis 31. Pick it up at verse 1. And he heard the words of Laban's son, saying, Jacob had taken away all that was our father's, and that which our father he had gotten all to his glory. In other words, accusing Jacob of stealing. Watch this. Verse 2. Jacob beheld the countenance of Laban, and behold, it was not towards him as before, when he first came as his beloved son-in-law, married to his two daughters, and everything was fine. Now he get rich, he increased exceedingly. Now the sons of him say, not all he get, like he steal it from our father. That's how he get rich. And now his countenance is not looking at him nice, not smiling, not hugging and kiss anymore. No, he looking at him, look at it. Look at verse 2. Jacob beheld the countenance of Laban, and behold, it was nothing before him. And the Lord said unto Jacob, return unto the land of thy fathers and to thy kindreds, and I will be with thee. You see, it's time to leave. I mean, you could overstay your welcome. Time to leave. Your wife and your children, you have money, now get out. Look at it. Verse 4. Jacob sent and called Rachel and Leah to the field unto the flock. And he said unto them, I see that your father countenance that it not towards me as not before, but the God of my father had been with me. And now I know with all my power I have served your father. Look at verse 7. Look at verse 7. Put your finger on verse 7. Look at it. Your father had deceived me 10 times, but God had suffered him not to hurt me. With persecution. You see, now he get rich. He's very rich. He's richer than Laban. Why? Because you remember, if you go back and read this, go back earlier and read the story with Jacob. When he left his father's house, Isaac, and he went to go to Jacob, he had a dream. And he promised God, he said, all that you will give me, I'll give a tenth back to you. I'll pay tithes back to you. So every time he get his money, he get $1,000, he pay a tenth. He get $100,000, he pay a tenth. He keep paying his tithes all the time. So he keep God being blessed and bring all the tithes, and I'll open you the windows of heaven and pour you out, bless me, no room to receive it. He said, I'll give you a tenth. So every time he get his money, he give a tenth back to God. So he's getting rich and rich and rich, and open the window, bless him. So he's becoming richer than his father-in-law Laban. Now his brother-in-law now accusing him of stealing from his father. You see, and he get very rich. So look at verse 7. Your father had deceived me and chained my wages 10 times, and God suffered him not to hurt. But look at something. Go over a little lower down in that same chapter with persecution. Yeah, now you get very rich. When he was poor, he was a nice boy. Now he's very rich. Persecution. With persecution. Go a little lower down in that same chapter. Go down to verse 38. Go down to verse 38. With persecution. Yeah, you get rich now. You accuse him of stealing from their father. Yeah, and he says countenance, the countenance, you know, he's not welcome. He's a chill welcome whenever he come around. They don't like him anymore. Now he's rich. Look at it. And that's the same thing in your household. You work, you save your money, you buy a car, you buy yourself a house, and get out of the ghetto. They don't like you anymore because you think you're better than them. And you know, when you get rich, now they say you're acting white. What is acting white? Yeah, you think you're white. Yeah, when you're poor, you're black. When you're rich, you're white. You're acting white. Look at this. Hallelujah. Genesis chapter 31, look at the 38th verse. This 20 years I have been with thee, the ewe lambs and the goats have I not cast their young, and the ram of thy flock have I not eaten. That which was torn by the beasts, I bought it not unto thee. I bear the loss of it, my hand did require it, whether it was stolen by day or stolen by night. Thus I was in the day, the drought consumed me, and the frost by night, and the sleep depart from my eyes. You see what he do to get it? You see what he do to get it? Verse 41. Thus I have been 20 years in thy house. I have served thee 14 years for thy two daughters, 6 years for the cattle, and thou hast changed my wages 10 times. Except the God of my father, the God of Abraham and Isaac hath been with me, surely thou hast sent me away empty, and the God hath seen my affliction, and I labor my hand, and rebuked thee yesternight. We have to read that again. You see what he do to get it? He said he frost by night and he drought by thy work. I worked 20 years together. I worked 14 years for your two daughters, and I worked 6 years to get all these cattle. See, I worked together. The man increased and become very rich, but he promised God, everything you give me, I'll give a tenth back to you. Let's read it again. Let's read it again. We need to read that again. How did he get it? He increased, he get very rich. And now his brother-in-law countenance not towards him as before. His father not looking up anymore. And they're accusing him of stealing. Look at it. Go back to verse 38. Every time he get his money, 10% is God money. Every time he gets his money, 10%. All that you'll give him, I give a tenth unto you. You make a covenant with God. Look at verse 38. 20 years I have been with him. The ewe lambs and the she-goat have not cast their youngs, and the ram of the flock have I not eaten. That which torn by the beast I bought not unto thee. I bear the loss of it. Of my hands did it not require. Whether it was stolen by day or by night, whatever it is stolen, I pay for it. Whatever I stand the losses by day or by night. Look at verse 40. Thus I was within the day, the drought consumed me, and the frost by night, and the sleep depart from my eyes. The sleep depart from my eyes, the drought by day and the frost by night. The sleep depart from I work together. Look at verse 41. Thus I have been 20 years in thy house, and I served thee 14 years for thy two daughters, 6 years for the cattle, and thou hast changed my wages 10 times. Time to rob it. Every time you get, you know, but he's been blessed. Who God bless you can't curse. Who God bless you can't curse. Can't do nothing about it. Who bless you can't curse. Look at it. Except the God of my father, the God of Abraham, and the fear of Isaac had been with me, surely thou hast sent me away empty. God hath seen my affliction and the labor of my hand and rebuked thee yesternight with persecution. Yeah, get the riches. Fine. With all your cattle, you get it with persecution. We see it throughout. Time you move to that level. You see it with the Apostle Paul. He was serving the devil fine. Everything was fine. The minute he received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, here there's a contract to kill him. 40 men under a great curse. They're not going to eat or sleep until we kill the Apostle Paul. And every time he moved up spiritually, as he started off his ministry, it was Barnabas and Saul. Barnabas and Saul. Then it changed around now with Saul and Barnabas. Saul and Barnabas. Climbing. We saw him first as a brother Saul. Then we saw him as a prophet or teacher. We saw him as a teacher. Then we saw him as an apostle. Every time he climbed, new levels, new oppositions. And the same thing going to happen to you. When you're down around, nobody knew you. The minute you start climbing, I can say that. I can say amen to that 100 times. We went and started ministry up in Elton Street. All the devils in hell came to visit. Every one of them. Like all of them was on duty at the same time. We went up there, the block association don't want us there. They make our life miserable. Neighbors on both sides of the house we was in was hostile neighbors. The community police officers make our lives miserable. The health department, the sanitation, the building department, everybody come out against us. And we stayed there and we fight, having done all to stand, stand. Amen. Having done all to stand. And in the process of time, we win them over. We become the best thing since the wheel. Hate us, but now we love them. Love will always beat hate. Love will always beat hate. Amen. Look at our Lord and Savior. I'll be remiss if I don't talk about my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 4. Look at when Jesus started his public ministry with persecution. Matthew chapter 4, and see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Get something to write with persecution. You'll see. You'll be calling my name in the process of time. Don't know why everybody like to get in my case, I know. God is blessing you. Once he start blessing you, they start messing. Amen, amen, and amen. Matthew chapter 4, look at Jesus, the head of the church. The one who operated in the fivefold ministry as an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and a teacher. He had the spirit without measure. And look at this, he's saying in his writing, if they persecute me, they're going to persecute you. Hallelujah. Look at Matthew chapter 4. Let's pick it about verse 23. Look at this. Matthew chapter 4, pick it about verse 23. And Jesus went all about Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. And his fame went throughout all Syria, and he brought on them all sick people that taken with divers disease and torment, those that were possessed with devils, those that were lunatic, and those that were palsy, and he healed them. And they follow him, great multitude, underlying great multitudes. They follow him, great multitude of people from Galilee, from Decapolis, from Jerusalem, and from Judea, and from beyond Jordan. Great multitude. How much is a great multitude? How much is a great multitude? When he fed with the 4 or 5 loaves and few fishes, they say it was over 4,000, 5,000 plus women and children. And here we're talking about a great. So unless we can stay at 10,000. Or we can make you feel all right, 5,000. 5,000 people is a lot of people. But it's a great multitude. Let's read that again. Started this public ministry. Look at this. Watch this. Look at the persecution. Watch this. Go back to verse 23. And Jesus went all about Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. And his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought on him all sick people are taken with divers disease and torment. Those that were possessed with devils, those that were lunatic, those that were palsy, and healed them. And they followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee, from Decapolis, from Jerusalem, and from Judea, and from beyond Jordan. All, that's a lot of people. Because when Jesus was, he ministered primarily in that strip of land called Palestine, was divided into three parts. One part of it is Galilee, the middle part of it is Samaria, the other part of it is Judea. So he ministered throughout there. So great multitude followed him throughout there. So it's one set of people that he ministered into. I mean, great multitude coming from that general region. So they come from Syria and so on, beyond Jordan and so on. So multitudes of people coming because of Jesus. Can you see that? Matthew chapter 12. Now, the same people, every time you go to Galilee, the multitude from Galilee pass through Samaria, multitude in Samaria, go to Judea, multitudes there, everywhere. Matthew chapter 12. Hallelujah. With persecution, he had the Spirit without measure. He operated in the fivefold ministry as an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. Matthew chapter 12. Let's pick it about verse 22. Matthew chapter 12. Let's pick it about verse 22. And they brought on him one possessed with a devil, blind and dumb. And he healed him insomuch that the blind and the dumb both spake and saw. And all the people were amazed and said, is not this the son of David? Look at verse 24. Look at verse 24. Put your finger on verse 24. All the people, same great multitude. Look at this. Look at verse 24. But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, this fellow do cast out devils by Beelzebub, the prince of devils. Yeah, take him from light now, they put him over in darkness. When the Pharisee heard it, they say, he working with Beelzebub, the prince of devils. That's how we're doing it. Amen. Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4. Great multitudes falling. Wherever he go, always a great multitude of people. Luke chapter 4. With persecution. Luke chapter 4. And see what God is saying to us in his holy written precious words. Luke chapter 4, let's pick it up on the 24th verse. With persecution, to trouble, to annoy constantly, to afflict or to harass constantly, to cause injury or distress. And sometimes to kill, because we saw it with Stephen. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 4. And let's pick up the 24th verse. Verily I say unto you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. I tell you the truth, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elias, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, with great famine was throughout all the land. But unto none of them was Elias sent, save Sarepta, a city of Sidon, unto a woman that was the widow. Many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elias, when the prophet, and none of them was cleansed, save Naaman the Syrian. And all that were in the synagogue, look at it, all that were in the synagogue heard these words, they were filled with wrath, and they rose up and they thrust him out of the city and led him onto the brow, onto the edge of the hill wherein the city was built, that they might cast him down headlong. But he passed through the midst of them and went his way. We have to read that again. All of them, look at it, all of them filled with wrath. Well, faith working by love, if they're filled with wrath, faith can't work there because there's no love there. Look at it again, verse 27. Many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elias, the prophet, but none of them was cleansed save Naaman the Syrian. And all there in the synagogue, when they heard these things, they were filled with wrath, and they rose up and thrust him out of the city and led him onto the brow of the hill wherein the city was built, that they might cast him down headlong, break his neck. But he passed through the midst of them. How do you like that? Jesus Christ, one who knew no sin, became sin. They're doing that to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If they persecute him, they're going to persecute you. Look at something else. In Big John chapter 8. Big John chapter 8, and see what he's saying about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Big John, look at this. Just extract this piece of reading here. Full of the Holy Ghost, operating the fivefold ministry. Big John. Chapter 8, look at two verses. Look at 58 and 59. Look at 58 and 59. With persecution. If they persecute him, they're going to persecute you. Look at that. Verse 58. Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Look at verse 59. And they took up stones to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. We have to read that again. Jesus hid. Jesus hid. The only Son of God, full of the Holy Ghost, had the Spirit without measure, operated in the fivefold ministry as an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. Look at the verse 58. Jesus said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I. And they took up stones to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, take up stone to cast at our Lord and Savior. Next time they thrust him out, lift him bodily, and take the trim off to break his neck. How you like that? With persecution. They persecute him, they're going to persecute you. Look at this. Big John chapter 15. Big John chapter 15. And look at this. And some of you could say amen to this. Big John chapter 15. Look at the 25th verse. I have a Relate edition. The head of the church is speaking. The Apostle John is recording. Big John chapter 15, look at the 25th verse. But this come to pass that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law. They hated me without a cause. Mm-hmm. You been there? Mm-hmm. I've been there myself. Mm-hmm. He said, I don't like him. Why you don't like the pastor? Well, I just don't like him. Why you don't like him? Well, I just don't like him. Mm-hmm. Why? Because he's black, because he's tall, because he's, why you don't like him? Why? I just don't like him. And they keep asking over and over, why they just can't, they don't know why. Mm-hmm. Why you don't, why? I just don't like him. And just mumble something in a foreign language. Mm-hmm. Why you don't like him? Can't tell you why, but just, well, let me tell you something. You that listening out, you better love me. If you don't love me, you can't go to heaven. He that hate his brother is a murderer, or no murderer have eternal life, so you better love me quick, quick, quick. If you hate me, you can't go to heaven. You're not going anywhere. If you hate me, your faith ain't gonna work, because faith working by love. Faith ain't gonna work. With all faith, it's impossible to please God. So you better love me. Say, I love the brother. Love the brother very much. You don't love me, no. If you hate me, you can't go to heaven. He that hates his brother is a murderer, and all murderer have no murderer have eternal life. Just for no reason. Look at that verse. But it's coming to pass that the words might be fulfilled that is written in their law, that they hated me without a cause. Don't know why they just hate me. Why? Well, just hate me. Just. Can't give you a reason, but just, you know. Just. Yeah. No murderer have eternal life. You hate, you can't go to heaven. Let me show you that scripture before you, and you mark it down. If you hate anybody as a Christian, you're not going anywhere. You're going to go to heaven gates. You're not going in there. First John, let's read it. It's not part of the study, but let's put it in for those who want to hate. They hate me without a cause. First John chapter 3, let's read it for you. First John chapter 3. First John chapter 3, you got it? Pick it up at verse 13. 1 John chapter 3, pick it up at verse 13. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that love not his brother abide in debt. He that love not his brother abide in debt. You living in debt. Look at the 15th verse. Put your finger on the 15th verse. Put your finger on the 15th verse. Whosoever hated his brother is a murderer. And know that no murderer have eternal life abiding in him. We have to read those verses again. Hate me without a cause. Why? People, church people, mm-hmm. Supposedly saved people, mm-hmm. Supposedly head of congregation people. You crazy with a big C. You're not going to heaven. You're not going to heaven. Can you read? Just love me. I just love the brother. Just love the brother. I disagree with a lot of people, but I don't hate them. I know better than that. If I hate them, my faith ain't gonna work. Faith working by love. You see, love your brother. I don't care what. I love you. Look at it. Let me read again to you. You are going to come before heaven gate, and you're not going anywhere. You're not going anywhere. Forget it. You're not going anywhere. You're not going to heaven. Let me read it for you. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that love not his brother abideth in death. He that love not his brother abideth in debt. he that loved not his brother abided in death. Look at the 15th verse. Whosoever hated his brother is a murderer, and ye know that no murderer have eternal life abiding in him. Hallelujah. Matthew 21. With persecution. Look at this. Matthew 21. I see what God is saying to us. Jesus coming towards the end of his earthly ministry, and he make his triumphant entrance into Jerusalem, and they give him a hero's welcome. Let's read and see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Matthew chapter 21. Let's speak about verse 8. A triumphant entry into Jerusalem, coming towards the end of his public ministry. Look at verse 8. And a great multitude spread their garment in the way. Others cut down branches from tree and strew them in the way. And the multitudes, underline multitudes with an S. Not multitude, but multitudes with an S. And the multitudes that went before him and followed, crying, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that come in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. I know. And when they were coming to Jerusalem, all the city, say all the city.
All the city.
Was moved, saying, who is this? And the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. We have to read that again. Triumphant. Triumphant Jesus. Victorious Jesus. We see just now. Same people who saying Hosanna in the highest. Same folks saying crucify him. Are you watching, see? Same multitude of people. Because Jesus ministered primarily through that strip of land called Palestine. Part of it is Galilee. Part of it is Samaria. And part of it is Judea. Look at a triumphant Jesus. Heal every manner of sickness and every manner of disease. Hate him without a cause. Why? They don't know why. They hate him. Why you hate him? Open blind eyes, on step deaf ears, the woman with the issue of blood, the woman with the spirit of infirmity, the man in the pool of Bethesda, Jairus' daughter, the widow of Nain's son, Lazarus, Mary Magdalene, man born blind, blind Bartimaeus, the blind man of Bethsaida, the two blind men. All this wonderful thing, everything he do, very good, but they hate him without a cause. Look at this. Can you read? Get something to write with and something to write on. It's coming to you. If they persecute him, they'll persecute you. Watch this. Look at verse 8. And a very great multitude spread their garment in the way, and others cut down branches from trees and threw them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and follow, crying, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that come in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the heights. And when he was coming to Jerusalem, all the city was moved. Who is this? And the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Yeah, we're going to turn the page. Big John chapter 19. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. With persecution. You living in a fool's paradise, you're going up the downstairs. You're going to be persecuted. If they persecute him, they're going to persecute you. Because of your husband, because of your wife, because of your money, because of your promotion that you get in your job, they're going to persecute you. That's just the way it is. That's just the way it is. Start way up there with Cain and Abel. Way up there. Yeah, Abel do what's right, Cain don't do what's right. And because of that, yeah, and you work hard. Here's Jacob going to Laban's house. He did everything he ought to do. Work. 14 years for his two daughters. 6 years he worked to get it. Yes. They envy him. Here's Isaac going on to Gerar. Everybody fleeing into Egypt. He's sowing that land. He got 100-fold. Abimelech said, you greater than us. Go from us. The Philistine envied him. As that which was, that which is, that which shall be done, that which is done, is nothing new under the sun. Big John chapter 19. And let's extract part of the story. Let's pick it up. Or the 14th verse. Big John chapter 19. And see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Big John chapter 19. You read the whole story, but let's pick up at verse 14. And it was the preparation of the Passover, and about the sixth hour, he said unto the Jews, behold your king. But they cried out, saying, away with him, away with him, crucify him. Pilate said unto them, shall I crucify your king? The chief priest with an S answered and said, "We have no king but Caesar." We have to read it again. Same folks who were saying a while ago, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest." Let's read that again. The chief priest, to be a chief priest, you have to do something to be a chief priest. You don't become a chief priest, get up one more and become a chief priest. You have to work at it. And chief priest with an S. Look at it, we're going to read that again. Away with him, crucify him. Look at it. Go back to verse 4. Read the whole story, but we just pick up that part of it and see what God is saying to us. Look at that, big John 19. Look at the 14th verse. And it was a preparation of the pastor about the sixth hour. And he said unto the Jews, "Behold your king." Your king. Look at verse 15. They cried, "Away with him. Away with him. Crucify him." Pilate said unto them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priest answered, "We have no king but Caesar." Yeah, we want the devil to reign over us. Caesar represents the kingdom of darkness. Jesus represents the kingdom of light. They don't want light to represent them. Light is coming to the world, but men rather darkness than light because they do the evil. Can you see that? I have to read that again. I like that. I read that again and see what God is saying to us. Look at that. Look at it one more time. Look at these verses there. Same people saying a while ago. Let's go back to Matthew 21 and come back to this again. I like this. Look at the contrast. Watch this. Matthew. Go back to Matthew 20 and read. Get something to write with and something to write on. Read. Get in the habit of reading. What was conspicuously absent in Jonestown, Guyana, no Bibles. In Waco, Texas, no Bible. Have get caught in, no Bible. Anytime you go to a church and no Bible, get out. And those of you who go to church, you know, everyone you walk into church Sunday morning holding your Bible up in the air like a sword. Now walk in the Bible, hold up your Bible. Everyone should have a scripture as you walk through the door. "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. He who began a good work in the seed in the air." It's not by power that everybody as you walk in, shout a scripture, hold up your Bible in the air. Hold up your sword. Yeah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Matthew 21. And look at verse 8 again. We look going back over that same verse again and see what he's saying. Look at this. Great multitude. Well, those same people who said crucify him, they were part of that great multitude. Because he ministered primarily through that strip of land, through Galilee and Samaria and Judea. So it's the same set of people. Every time you go to Galilee, the multitudes will come up from there. You go to pass through Samaria, multitude, go up to Judea, multitudes everywhere he go. Verse 8. Very great multitude spread their garment in the way and cut down branches from trees and strew them in the way. And the multitudes with an S that went before and follow Christ, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is he that come in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest." And when he was coming to Jerusalem, all the city, not somebody, see, all the city, because it all the city was moved and saying, "Who is this?" And the multitude said, "This is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee." Can you see that? Let's go back to Big John. Crucify him. Crucify him. Whatever happened to thou shall not kill. And notice who's saying it, the chief priest. Didn't he read the law? Thou shall not kill. Then he doesn't know that part of the law. Thou shall not, but crucify him. Whatever happened to that part of the law? Thou shall not kill. Amen, amen, and amen. Hallelujah. Look at those two verses. In Big John 19, look at 14 and 15. Faith cometh by hearing, by hearing, by hearing, by hearing. Faith doesn't come by having heard it. Faith cometh. ETH, continuous. Faith cometh by hearing, by hearing, by hearing, by hearing. Look at those two verses. 14 and 15. And it was the preparation of the Passover, and about the sixth hour, he said unto the Jews, "Behold your king." But they cried out, saying, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." And he said unto them, "Shall I crucify your king?" And the chief priests, whatever happened to thou shall not kill. Whatever happened to that? And look at the chief priests, not the regular priests, the chief priests. You see, in other words, we could say the high priests. Well, the regular priest ministered to the needs of the people from day to day, but the high priest is the only one who could go into the holies of holies. So the chief priest went to the holies of holies, all the people sinned once year and covered their sin for 1 year, the chief priest. And look what the chief priest is saying. But they cried out, saying, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." And Pilate said unto them, "Shall I crucify your king?" And the chief priests, "We have no king but Caesar. Can you see that? Hallelujah. Let's go back to Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10. And these are the verses that we're using as the 12 inches to make our foot. M-A-R-K is Mark. Mark chapter 10. And let's read the story. Mark chapter 10. Got something to write with. And something to write on 54 minutes after the first hour. This is Choice Radio 92.9 FM. Your life, your salvation, your choice. This is the Christian Family on Choice Radio. Telephone number, the church, 347-533-4271. At the studio, 347-663-8638. Write these numbers down. You're going to need them. Mark chapter 10, and let's pick up the story at verse 17. These are the verses that we use as the 12 inches to make our foot. Looking at with persecution. What does it mean to persecute, to trouble, to annoy, constantly, to afflict, or to harass, constantly, to cause injury or to distress, and sometimes to kill because of your race, your religion, your politics, and many other things. Persecution because of your blessing. And we saw that throughout here. Mark chapter 10, pick up at verse 17. And when he was gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled on him and said, "Good master, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus answered and said, "Why callest thou me good? There's none good but one, that's God. Thou knowest the commandment, do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, honor thy father and thy mother." And he answered and said unto them, "Master, all these have I observed from my youth." Jesus beholding him and loved him and said unto him, "Oh, one thing lackest thou. Go thy way, sell whatsoever thou have, give to the poor, thou shalt have treasures in heaven. Take up thy cross and follow me." And he was sad at that saying, and he was grieved, and he went away because he had great possession. Jesus looked round about and said unto his disciples, "How hard it is they that have riches enter the kingdom of God." His disciples answered, was astonished at the words, but Jesus answered and said unto them, "Children, how hard it is they that trust in riches enter the kingdom of God. For it is easier for a camel to go through the eyes of a needle than a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." And they were astonished out of measure, saying among themselves, "Then who then can be saved?" Jesus looked round about and said, "With men it's impossible, with God all things are possible." Peter began to say unto him, "Lord, we have left all and followed thee." Jesus answered and said, "Verily I say unto thee, that no man have left house and brethren and sister and father and mother or wife and children or land for my sake and for the gospel, but he shall receive 100-fold now in this time, brethren and sisters and mother and children and lands with persecution, and the world to come eternal life. Many that are first shall be last, and the last shall be first." Amen. Amen and amen. How you like that? Glory to God. With persecution. Hallelujah. Now, how you deal with persecution? Now, we talk about how we've been persecuted. We look at, go right back to Genesis. We look at Paul being persecuted. We look at Peter. We look at John. We look at all these people who've been persecuted. How you deal with persecution? 2 Timothy. How we deal with persecution. What to do when you've been persecuted? Let's see what God is saying to us. How you deal with it. What do I do? I've been persecuted. What to do? Run and hide? Flee? I don't think so. 2 Timothy. How you deal with persecution. What do you do when persecution comes? Hallelujah. 2 Timothy. Chapter 3. What do I do? Look at verses 11 and 12. 2 Timothy. Chapter 3. Look at verses 11 and 12. "Persecutions and affliction that came unto me at Antioch and Iconium and at Lystra, what persecution I endure, but out of them all, the Lord deliver me." Look at verse 12. Yeah. "All that shall live godly." We have to read those verses again. Mm-hmm. Notice who deliver him? You notice who deliver him? Look at that. Look at those two verses again. Look at those verses. Persecution, notice with an S, persecution an S, "and affliction that came unto me at Antioch, Iconium, and at Lystra, what persecution I endure, but out of them all the Lord deliver me. Yea, all that shall live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." So if you live in godly in Christ Jesus, you're going to have persecution. Well, how do you deal with it? How do I deal with persecution? I don't know. Well, tell me. Well, let's see what to do. He said, all that shall live godly. So if you live in God, you're going to have persecution. Sometimes it's from within with your family. Sometimes it's from without. But sometimes it's from within. How do I deal with it? Look at the book of James. Look at the book of James. And see what God is saying to us. James chapter 4. All that shall live godly shall suffer. What do I do about persecution? Hand up your birth certificate, run, go and live in an island that nobody there. What do you do? James chapter 4. Look at the 7th verse. James chapter 4. What do I do about persecution? Hallelujah. Submit yourself therefore to God, resist the devil, and he shall flee from you. But notice these things that you have to do for him to flee. Somebody will say, resist the devil and shall flee. No. That's only part of it. Resist the devil and shall flee. No. Submit yourselves to God. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the devil and he shall flee. Submit yourself, number one, to God. Not to, you know, not by might or power, but by the Spirit. Submit yourself to God, therefore. Resist the devil and he shall flee. Now, how do I do that? I'm glad you asked. Look at that verse again. Submit yourself therefore to God, resist the devil, and he shall flee from you. Let's go back to the Kings and see something. Let's see how Solomon handled it. Let's see how Solomon deal with it. 1 Kings chapter 4. And let's get some and see how they handle it and how you could handle it. 1 Kings chapter 4. Let's see how Solomon handled. 1 Kings chapter 4. Submit yourself therefore to God. Resist the devil, but submit to God first. Resist the devil and he shall flee. Every time you come to Jesus, you say, it is written. It is written. It is written. And Jesus was quoting from the book of Deuteronomy to the devil. Well, if Jesus could quote from the book of Deuteronomy and get the devil to back up under the old covenant, you have a new covenant, a better covenant established upon better promises. Those folks under the old covenant wasn't saved. They were servants, we are sons. And Jesus quoted from the book of Deuteronomy, it is written, it is written, it is written, submit yourself to God, resist the devil and he'll flee. You see, but submit to God first. Look at this here in Kings, and look at Solomon. Let's get a little background on Solomon. 1 Kings chapter 4. All persecution will come, God deliver me from them all, and all that should live godly. So if you're living godly, expect persecution. If you're not being persecuted, maybe you're not living godly. But based on what the Bible say, all that shall live godly in Jesus Christ shall suffer persecution. 1 Kings, let's go back there and see how Solomon handled. 1 Kings chapter 4, let's pick it up at the 29th verse. 1 Kings chapter 4, look at verse 29. And God gives Solomon wisdom and understanding exceedingly much, largeness of heart, even as the sand that is on the seashore. Solomon's wisdom excelled the wisdom of all the children of the east country and all the wisdom of Egypt. For he was wiser than all men, than Ethan the Ezraite, than Hinan and Kalkar and Dada the son of Mahal. And his fame was in all nations round about. And he speak 3,000 proverbs, and his songs were 1,005. And he speak of trees and of cedars and of Lebanon, even the hyssop and the spring out of the wall. He spake also of the beasts and of the fowl and of the creeping things and of the fish. And there came all the people to hear the wisdom of Solomon, of all the kings of the earth, which had heard of his wisdom. We have to read that again. Now remember, a very wise man. But how he deal with persecution? What did he tell us to do? Let's read that again. And God gave Solomon wisdom and understanding exceeding much and largeness of heart, even as the sand that is on the seashore. That's a lot.
Yes,
you know my sand is on the seashore? That much. Solomon's wisdom exceed the wisdom of all the children of the east country and all the wisdom of Egypt. So nobody in Egypt is wiser than Solomon. For he was wiser than all men. He was wiser than all men. Can you see that? Than Ethan, the Israelite, and Heman, and Calcor, and Dada, the son of Mahal, and his fame was in all nations round about. And he speak 3,000 proverbs, and his songs was 1,005. He speak of the trees, of the cedar tree, and of that is in Lebanon, even the hyssop that sprung out of the wall. He spake also of the beasts and of the fowl and creeping things and of the fishes, all everything Solomon speak about. That's something else. Yeah? And there came all the people to hear the wisdom of Solomon from all the kings of the earth, which had heard of his wisdom. Look at what Solomon said to do. Look at Proverbs. He wrote Proverbs. Look at Proverbs chapter 25. Proverbs chapter 25. I see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious word. How do we deal with persecution? Proverbs chapter 25, he's given credit for right words. Spirit of God, of course. But that's a lot he gave to Solomon. Wiser than all men. And look how he's going to deal. Look what he tells us to do. Proverbs 25, look at two verses. Look at 21 and 22. If thy enemy be hungry, give him bread to eat. And if he is thirsty, give him water to drink. For thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head, and the Lord shall reward thee. We have to read that again. How you deal with persecution? People that persecute, how you deal with them? Look at what Solomon said. We just read how much information that God gave to Solomon. Look at this. How you deal with it? Out of them all, the Lord deliver me. All that shall live God in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, shall suffer persecution. Look at those two verses. If somebody put us to tell us what to do, but what we do, we're trying to fight fire with fire. You hate me, so I hate you. You curse me, so I curse you. You spit on me, so I spit on you. You mess with my wife, I mess with your wife. You mess with my husband, so I mess with your husband. Look what he said to do. Watch this, look at 21. If thine enemy be hungry, give him bread to eat. And if he be thirsty, give him water to drink. For thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head. And you're doing that, you're putting fire upon his head. And look at the next part of it. And the Lord shall reward you. And the Lord shall reward you. How you deal with persecution. Can you see that? Look at Elijah, the son of Shaphat. Watch this. Let's give a little background of him. 2 Kings chapter 2. Elijah, the son of Shaphat, how he deal with it. What do he do? In the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. Now Elijah was the understudy, Elijah the Tishbite, and Elijah did quite a bit of stuff when he was here. He, the raven, bring him bread, and this is Elijah the Tishbite, bring him bread and meat in the morning and evening. He went to the widow's house, and he said, give me the cake in your hand. And she gave it to him, and he said, if you give it to me, the meal will never run out throughout the family that had food. While he was there, her son died, and he prayed to come back to life. He went up against 450 prophets of Baal. He made fire come down from heaven and consumed the messenger of the king. He did many mighty things. He take his mantle and hit the Jordan River, and it parted. So this Elijah teaches that with quite a bit of stuff. But this is his understudy, Elijah the son of Shaphat. Look at this, 2 Kings chapter 2. 2 Kings chapter 2. How you deal with persecution? Well, we see how Solomon dealt with it. Look at this here. 2 Kings chapter 2, pick it up at verse 9. Elijah the Tishbite come towards the end of his earthly ministry. And he said, well, I'm going to Bethel. He said, well, I come in with you. You see, sometimes these are the facets of revelation. If you want what somebody have and it's good, Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. Well, here Elijah the son of Shaphat want what Elijah the Tishbite have. So he said, I'm going to Bethel. He said, I'm coming with you. He went with him to Bethel. He said, no, we're going to Jericho. He said, I'm coming there too. Then you go into Jordan. He said, I'm coming there too. He crossed the Jordan. He crossed the Jordan too. He wants what he has. So you have to work to get it. We have decided, because God called the ministry, just lay in your bed all day long, eat fried chicken, and look at worldly TV, and then you'll get, it doesn't work like that. You know, God called him to ministry. God told him, anoint him to stand in that office. He anointed, but yet he going to Bethel, he going with him to Bethel. He gone to Jericho, he gone to him to Jericho. He gone to the Jordan, he gone to the Jordan. He crossed the Jordan, he crossed the Jordan. Look at this, he getting ready to leave. Pick up about verse 9. Elisha, 2 Kings chapter 2, pick up about verse 9. Just read a few verses. And came to pass when they were gone over, Elisha said to Elisha, ask what I shall do for thee before I'm taken away from thee. And Elisha said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. And he said, thou hast asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if thou see me when I'm taken from thee, it shall be unto thee. But if not, it shall not be so. You see, you have to keep his eyes open. You want it, keep your eyes open. Look at verse 11. And it came to pass as they went still on, that he talked and both, he talked and they, look at verse 11 again. And it came to pass as they still went on and they talked, that behold, there appeared chariots of fire and horses of fire are parted asunder, and Elisha went up in a whirlwind into heaven. So he said, if you see me, I'm taken up. So he get a double anointing of what his boss had. He said, if you see me, you're going to get it. He said, I want twice as much of what you have. I want to do twice as much of what you did. And God granted him his request. But look at this, how he dealt with persecution. 2 Kings chapter 6. Now this story here is about the children of the Syrians coming to invade Israel. Every time they have a battle plan to come and invade Israel, they come to town, Israel will be gone out of town. They said they're coming in one city, they come to that city, they couldn't find Israel. They made another blood plan, went to another city, they come, they're gone again every time they come. So the king of Syria saying, somebody's spying here and telling the children of Israel that when we come to town. And one of his sons said, no, it's Elijah, the son of Shaphat, he's the one telling them what you say in your bedchamber, telling to the king. And again, no, he said, well, let's go and get rid of Elijah. So they came by night and they surround the city of Dotham where he was. And when his servant gave him morning, you see the place is surrounded with all these Syrian troops. And he fly back inside and tell his boss, we in trouble. They surround us, this mighty army surround the house. He said, don't listen to them, they're full of it. We could handle it. He said, it's just both of us, it's a multitude of them out there. He said, never mind. And God, he prayed God to open his eyes, He said, a multitude of heavenly hosts. So Elisha come outside. Now one man against the entire army. Some look at this. 2 Kings chapter 6. Let's pick up the story. At the 18th verse, how we deal with those who persecute you. Look at it. 2 Kings chapter 6, let's pick it out, verse 18. And when they were come down to Elijah, pray him, he said unto the Lord, I say, smite these people, I pray thee, with blindness. And he smote them with blindness. So the entire army of Syria was blind, strike with blindness. Now they was blind, they could see, but they couldn't see, because he lead them into Samaria. Verse 19, Elijah said unto them, this is not the way, neither this is the city. Follow me, and I'll bring you to the man whom you seek. And he led them to Samaria. And it came to pass when they were coming to Samaria, that Elijah said, Lord, open the eyes of these men, and that they may see. And the Lord opened their eyes, and they saw, behold, they were in the midst of Samaria. So you see, they could see, but they can't see. Look at verse 21. And the king of Israel said to Elijah, when he saw them, my father, shall I smite them? Shall I smite them? Look at verse 22. Look at verse 22. Put your finger on verse 22. Then he answered, shall thou smite them that would smite thee, whom thou hast taken captive, with a sword and with thy bow? Set bread and water before them, that they may eat and drink and go to their masters. And they prepared them a great provisions for them. And when they had eaten and drunk, he sent them away, and they went to their masters. So the band of Syrians came no more into the land of Israel. We have to read that again. How you deal with those who persecute you? Here is a mighty army come to wipe them out. And now they blind their eyes, take them into Samaria, the capital of Israel. And he said, well, should we smite them? Should we smite them? Look at verse 21. And the king of Israel said unto Elijah, when he had saw them, my father, shall I smite them? Shall I smite them? And he answered, thou shalt not smite them. Wouldest thou smite those whom have thou taken captive with thy sword and with a bow? Set bread and water before them, that they may eat and drink and go to their masters. And they prepared them a great provision for them. And when they had eaten and have drunk, send them away, and they went their way to their masters, so the band returned no more. You see how we did? Now he has a double portion. We saw Solomon was very wise, the wisest man of the time. He had twice as much of what Elijah the Tishbite had. And this is where he dealt with it, those who persecute you. Look at what he said. Set bread and water before them, don't smite them, and feed them and let them go. When your enemy hungry, feed them. Can you see that? Amen, amen, and amen. Hallelujah. Look at Joseph. Joseph was treated very badly. Is that true? Genesis chapter 4, chapter 50. Genesis chapter 50. And look at Joseph. Joseph's brethren sold him to the Egyptians. Well, they sold him. They put him in a pit. The menials come and pick him out of the pit, and the Ishmaelites take him, and they went down to Egypt. They sold him into Potiphar's house in the bondage because they hated the brother, and so on. So he was in Potiphar's house. While in Potiphar's house, Potiphar's wife told a lie on him, and they put him into serious prison. While in prison, he interpreted the dream of the butler and the baker. He told the baker, you're going to be hanged, but the butler, you're going to be restored to your position. So the butler was restored to his position. Process of time, favor had a dream. Nobody could interpret the dream. The butler said, now remember my fault. When I was incarcerated, this man interpreted my dream. Send and call him. So they sent and called Joseph, and they put Joseph there and interpreted the dream for Pharaoh, 7 years of plenty and 7 years of famine, and so on and so on. And he stayed there. Process of time, Joseph sent for his brothers, the same one who treated him very badly. He sent for them, treated them very well, and so on. He didn't get even with Potiphar and his wife for incarcerating him wrongfully. No, that's not the way to deal with it. How you handle persecution? So, the old man is died, Jacob died, and the children now left behind. Look at this story, pick up the story. Genesis chapter 50. Dealing with persecution. How you deal with those who persecute you? Look at it. Now Jacob died, and the 12 tribe behind. Joseph now is running all of Egypt. Genesis chapter 50. Let's pick up the 15th verse. Genesis chapter 50. Let's pick up the 15th verse. And when Joseph's brethren saw that their father was dead, and they said to Joseph, will peradventure hate us, and will certainly require of us all the evil which we did unto him. All the evil which we did unto him. But you don't fight fire with fire, don't fight evil with evil. Look at all the evil which we had done unto him. And they sent messenger unto Joseph, saying, thy father did command before he died, saying, so shall you say unto Joseph, forgive, I pray thee, now the trespass of thy brethren and their sins, for they did unto evil. Now we pray thee, forgive the trespass of thy servants of the God of thy father. And Joseph wept when he speak unto him. And his brethren also went and fell down before his face and said, behold, we are thy servants. Look at verse 19. Look at verse 19. And Joseph said unto his brethren, said unto them, fear not, for I am in the place of God. But as for you, you taught evil against me, but God meant it for good to bring to pass at this day to save my people alive. Look at verse 21. Wow. Can you do that? You know what God going to say to some of you when you go before him? Christians going before the judgment seat of Christ. Say, this guy wasn't even saved. You are born again. You have a new spirit. He's operating two cylinders, soul and body. When Adam sinned in the garden, everybody died. He was dead spiritually. And look at his behavior. They had the Spirit of God upon them and acting as servants in those offices. You are born again, you are son. Look at verse 21. Now therefore fear not, I will nourish you and your little ones. And he comforted them and speak kindly unto them. How you like that? Could you do that to your ex-husband, your ex-wife, people who wrong you on your job, people who did treat you very badly? Tell lies on you, some break up your marriage and did different things. Could you be like that? Let's read that again. When you go to stand before God, you go say, listen, he wasn't even saved. He wasn't even saved. He wasn't even saved. You're going before the judgment seat of Christ. Can you do that? Yeah, he's going to bring all this up to you. How you handle persecution. Look at it. 15 verse. When Joseph's brethren saw that their father was dead, they said to Joseph, will you peradventure hate us? And certainly require of us all the evil that we have done unto him. They know they did evil. You see, they know they know evil unto him. Where many years, since he was a little boy, not a grown man. Look at it. The evil we have done unto him. And they send messenger unto Joseph, saying, thy father did command before he died, saying, so shall you say unto Joseph, forgive, I pray thee now, the trespass of thy brethren and their sins, as they did unto the evil, that they did unto the evil, that they did unto the evil. Now, we pray thee, forgive their trespass and all the servants of thy God and of thy father. And Joseph wept when they speak unto him. And his brethren also went and fell down before his on their faces. And they said, behold, we are thy servants. And Joseph said unto them, fear not, for I am the place of God. You see, that's the way God deals. I am the place of God. All the wrong things we do, God forgive us. God forgive us. God forgive us. Verse 20. But as for you, you taught evil against me, but God meant it for good. unto the good, to bring to pass that it is this day to save much people alive. Look at verse 21. Look at verse 21. That's something else. That's her. That's something else. Reading a story some years ago about a family send their daughter out to South Africa to start to do some work out if the people help them with school and trade and things like that, and they murder her. And it was very sad. And the mother and the father, this child, have to go out there and they start a ministry in her name. And the same people who ill-treated their daughter, they start a ministry and get them. They were incarcerated, get them to come and work there. That's love. That is something else. Yeah. You know, my daughter is not going to die in vain. I'm not going to return hate with hate. We're going to show love. And they named the organization, whatever it was, in her name. The very people who murdered their daughter have to face them. Okay, we forgive you. We forgive you. How deep in Christianity they are. But what about you, your ex-husband and your ex-wife? Things that happened in your younger life. Still hold on to that. Look at it. He wasn't even saved. He wasn't even saved. What about you? Let me say this to you. You're not going to heaven. Unforgiveness is not going to heaven. Forgive. Forgive. Look at verse 21. Now therefore, fear not. I'll nourish you and your little ones. And he comforted them and speak kindly unto them. How Joseph handled it. Look at the head of the church, Jesus Christ. How he handled it. Just come a little closer to home. Look at our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. 20 minutes after the second hour. Look at our Lord and Savior handled it. Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 5, I have a red edition, the head of the church speaking. Matthew is recording. Matthew chapter 5, how we handle persecution. Out of them all, the Lord deliver me. Matthew chapter 5, let's pick up the 43rd verse. Look at the head of the church speaking. Matthew chapter 5, let's pick up verse 43rd. You heard that it has been said that thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies, and bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh the sun to rise on the evil and on the good. He sendeth rain on the just and the unjust. If you love them which love you, what reward have you? Doth even the publican the same? If you salute your brethren only, what do you more than others? Do not even the publican so? Be you therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is, look at the tense use, is perfect. We have to read that again. I say, look how the head of the church handled. Look how the head of the church handled. We see a pattern throughout from way up in Genesis. We see a pattern throughout. If you how to deal with persecution. How to deal with persecution. Look at it. What is that 43rd? You have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies with an S. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. Pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh the sun to rise on the evil and on the good. He sendeth rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love them which love you, what reward have you? Even the publican the same. If you salute your brethren, what do you more than others? Not even the publican so? Be you therefore perfect. Be you therefore perfect. So if you love your enemy, you could be perfect. Can you read? How readest thou? Be you therefore perfect as the Father which is in heaven is perfect. Can you see that? Height of love. Look at Luke. Look at Luke chapter 22. Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, Luke chapter 22. Jesus' last days in the land of the living, before he going back to be at the right hand of the Father. Watch this. Luke chapter 23rd. The 23rd chapter, the gospel according to Luke. And let's pick it up at the 32nd verse. Luke chapter 23. Look at the 32nd verse. And there were also two other malefactors led with him to be put to death. Quite a scene. When they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucify him, and the malefactors, one on the right and the other on the left. Look at verse 34. Look at verse 34. Put your finger on verse 34. Look at what he said. Jesus said, Father, Forgive them, for they knew not what to do. They parted his raiment and cast lots. We have to read that again. Quite an environment. Two thieves, a mass hanging on the hill. Calvary, place of skull, Golgotha. Up there. Look at what Jesus said after they treat him very badly. For no reason. He who knew no sin became sin for you. He who knew no sin became sin. For hardly for a righteous man one would die while you were yet sinning. And they treat him very badly. And look at him on the cross. After they put a crown of thorn, they buffeted him, treated him very badly. Put the nails in his hands and his feet. Put the nails, they put him up on the cross, hanging from the 6th hour to the 9th hour, getting ready to leave the land of the living. 6 hours, nails in his hands. That's something else. Crown of thorn on his head, beaten to a pulp, buffeted, treated very, very badly. And hanging there, 3 hours without those times, from the 6 hour to the 9th hour, hanging on the cross, blood streaming down all of him, stark naked. And look what he's saying up on the cross. Look at those verses. And there were also 2 other malefactors led with him to be put to death. Then they will come to the place which is called Calvary. There they crucify him. The malefactor on the right and the one on the left. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they knew not what they do. Can you see that? Forgive them. 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. Treat our Lord and Savior very bad. If some of you would get Christians we're talking to, you would come to church. You would come to church. You would be in church early. You would be there. You would know Sunday, that's the Lord's day. Not the Lord's hour. That's the Lord's day. Crucify the Lord a second time. Wouldn't even come to church. Wouldn't even come to church. 1 Peter. Chapter 2. By the time I think about my Lord and Savior, I think about it, I don't have to go to hell, I go into heaven. Will somebody die for me while I was yet sinning? Pay the price for me. He was delivered for my offenses and he raised again for my justification. He declared me righteous because of what he did. You have that kind of revelation. You'll come to church.
Yes.
You'll get up Sunday morning. I'll spend all day there sprawl out in church. Now, this is the Lord's day. I'll get up every morning early, give the Lord the first hour. I'll be just talking about my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. Yeah, look at it. 1 Peter 2, look at the 21st verse. 1 Peter chapter 2, look at verse 21. For him hereunto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow in his steps. S-T-E-P-S, steps. We have to read that again. I said we have to read that again. Look at that verse. Put your finger on the 21st verse, 1 Peter chapter 2. And see what God is saying to us there. Hallelujah. 1 Peter chapter 2, look at verse 21. Or hereunto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us. Put your name by us, leaving us an example that we should follow in his steps. Look how Paul handled it. We look at Solomon, we look at Elijah, we look at Joseph, we look at Jesus, look at Paul. How he handled persecution. Acts chapter 16. Acts chapter 16, how you deal with it? People who persecute you, how you deal with them? Acts chapter 16, and see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious word with persecution. Acts chapter 16, let's pick it up at the 16th verse. Acts chapter 16, let's pick it up at the 16th verse. And it came to pass when one prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same follow Paul on us and Christ, saying, these men are servants of the Most High God, will show us the way of salvation. This she did many days. Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. And when her master saw that the hope of the gain was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them onto the marketplace, onto the rulers. and they brought them to the magistrate, saying, "These men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city, and teach custom which is not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Roman." And the multitude, underline the word multitude, and the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrate rent their clothes, commanded to beat them. When they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into the prison and charged the jailer to keep them safely. Who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prison was shaken, and immediately all the doors were open, and every man bound were loose. And the keeper of the prison awake out of the sleep, seeing the prison door open, and drew his sword and would have killed himself. Go ahead, kill yourself. Go ahead, kill yourself. Have yourself a ball, Paul. Kill yourself. Supposing that the prisoner had fled, Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, we're all here." No, kill yourself. You want to kill us, so you kill yourself. You put a good beating and put us in the inner prison, you kill yourself. Look at it. Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, for we're all here." Then he called for a light and sprang in and came and trembled and fell down before Paul and Silas. And they brought him out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" You know where you can go. Save. You know where you can go. And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house." And they speak unto him these words of the Lord and all that were in his house. And he took them the same night, and they washed their stripes, and they were baptized the same night. Look at verse 34. When he had brought them into his house, he set before them meat and rejoiced, believing the God with all his house. You have to read that again. You have to read that again. Multitude rose and put a good beating. How many of you could be getting a good beating and you praying and singing praises to the Lord? How many of you could do that? You want to kill himself? Well, so go ahead. Help yourself. Go ahead. Kill yourself. Look at it. Look at it. Let's go back up. Let's go back up to the 19th verse. Go back up to the 19th verse. How do you handle persecution? Those who persecute you. How do you handle? Look at verse 19. And when her master saw that the hope of the gain was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them onto the marketplace, unto the rulers. And they brought them to the magistrate, saying, "These men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city, teach custom which is not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans." And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrate rent their clothes and commanded to beat them. The multitude, how much is a multitude? Commanded to beat them. When they had laid many stripes, you know what the word many is? You know what the word many is? Many stripes upon them, they cast them into the prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. Who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prison was shaken, and immediately all the doors were open, and every man bound were loose. And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of the sleep, seeing the prison doors open, drew his sword and would have killed himself. Go ahead. Kill yourself. Look at it. Supposing that the prisoner has fled, Paul cried with a loud voice, said, "Do thyself no harm, for we are all here." Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas. And they brought him out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" "What must I do to be saved?" And he said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, thou and shalt be saved in thy house." And they speak all these words of the Lord and all that were within his house. And took them the same night and washed their stripes, and were baptized there and all his straightway. And when he was brought them into his house, he said before them, "Meet, rejoice, believing God in all his house," and etc., etc. How Paul deal with it? Look at the book of Romans. Those who persecute, how you deal with them? Romans chapter 12. Is Romans in the Bible?
Yes, it is.
Just want to make sure we're in the B-I-B.
Okay.
Early, Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. Hallelujah. 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 Romans chapter 12. Let's pick up the 14th verse. 33 minutes after the second hour. Get something to write with and something to write on. Romans chapter 12. Let's pick up at verse 14. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. Bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice and weep with them that do weep. Be of the same mind one towards another. Mind not things which are high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in thy own conceit. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it is possible, as much as light within you, live peaceable to all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I'll repay, said the Lord. Look at verse 20. Look at verse 20. Therefore, if thy enemy hungry, did we see that all of the, if thy enemies, look at it. If thy enemy hungry, feed him. If he thirsty, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head. Be not overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. We have to read that again. How you deal with those who persecute you. Turn the other cheek. Verse 14. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that do weep. Be of the same mind one towards another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in thy own conceit. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in sight of all men. If it possible, as much as light within you. Live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I'll repay, said the Lord. Verse 20. Therefore, if thine enemy hungry, feed him. If he thirsty, give him drink. And in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head. Be not overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. Look at Paul painting a picture here of love. Like he's sitting in a chair and love is sitting on a seat and he's writing a picture, giving us a portrait of love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. 1 Corinthians, how do you overcome those that persecute? How do you overcome out of them all? The Lord deliver me. Yeah, you see how to do it. You hate and they hate, and you hate more, they hate more. You know, you're going down. You playing in their field. When David was going before Goliath, the king gave him a uniform to put on. He said, no, it doesn't fit. If he tried to fight Goliath in his turn, Goliath would beat him. He's no match for Goliath. No, you come to me with sword and spear. I come to you in the name of the God of Israel. You come in your, you fight in your battle. I fight in my battle. This is my, this is winning side. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Paul dealing with those who persecute. Pick it up at verse 1. Though I speak with tongues of men and of angels and have not charity or love, I become a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbals. Though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and have all knowledge, and though I have all faith so I can remove mountains and have not love or charity, I am nothing. Though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I have given my body to be burned and have not love or charity, it profit me nothing. Charity suffer long, it is kind, charity envy not, charity vaunted not itself, it is not puffed up, do not behave itself unseemly, seek not its own, it is not easily provoked, think no evil, rejoice not in iniquity, but rejoice in the truth, bear all things, believe all things, hope all things, endure all things. Charity never fail, whether they be prophecy, they shall fail, whether they be tongues, they shall cease, whether they be knowledge, they shall vanish away, for we know in part, and we do prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away with. When I was a child, I speak as a child. I understood as a child. I taught as a child. But when I become a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as I am also known. Look at verse 13. Put your finger on verse 13. Look at the 13th verse. Put your finger on the 13th verse. Now abided faith, hope, and charity or love. These three, the greatest of these, is love. Faith working by love. Without faith, it's impossible to give. If you don't have love, faith don't work. And you are saved by grace through faith. You can't get saved. Oh, the greatest of these, glory to God, is love. We have to read that again. We have to read that again. Hallelujah. We got to read that again. A picture, a portrait of love. How love should believe. You should use this as your 12 inches. To see how you measure. How we're done. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And verse 1. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity or love, I become a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbals. Although I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mystery and understand all and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so I can remove mountain and have no charity, I am nothing. Although I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have no charity, it profit me nothing. Charity suffer long, it is kind, it envy not. Charity vaunted not itself, it is not puffed up. It do not behave itself unseemly. Seek not our own, it is not easily provoked. Think no evil. Rejoice not in iniquity, but rejoice in the truth. Bear all things, believe all things, hope all things, endure all things. Charity never fail. Whether they be prophecy, they shall fail. Whether they be tongue, they shall cease. Whether she be knowledge, shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect will come, that which is in part shall be done away with. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I taught as a child. But when I become a man, I put away childish thing. Now I see through a glass darkly, but then shall face to face. Now I know in part, then shall I know even as I also am known. Verse 13. Put your finger on verse 13. Look at the 13th verse. Now abideth faith, hope, and charity, or love. These three the greatest. The greatest. How Paul handled it. Those that persecute him. How Stephen handled it. Acts chapter 7. Acts chapter 7. Acts chapter 7, Stephen. Let's see how he handled it. Acts chapter 7. And they stoned Stephen to death. But look what he do. What should you do? Acts chapter 7. With persecution. How to deal with those who persecute you. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 7. Stephen. Come towards the end of his earthly ministry. He is the first person recorded in the New Covenant. When he died, went up. Everybody else died, went down. When Adam sinned in the garden, everybody died spiritually. And they went into hell, a part of hell. Those who know had a promissory note on salvation. They went into Abraham's bosom. The rest of people went down to the lower part to be tormented. And so when Jesus died, went into hell and preached to those who was in Abraham's bosom, I take them unto the Father. Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and let the King of Glory come in. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord of hosts, the Lord mighty in battle. He went to hell. So the first person reported when they die going up to be absent from the body to be present with the Lord is Stephen. Everybody else died, went down. He's the first one recorded when he died, went up. All of us who are Christian, when we die, we're going up. If you should die and you start going down, you miss it. If you're going down, mean you're dead twice. You're spiritually separated from God, and you die physically, your spirit and your soul leave your body. Those of us, the Bible says, appointed unto man once to die. He wants us to die one time, not twice, once. Appointed unto man once to die. See, we were born from our mother womb, then we were born again. So we were born twice, we're going to die once. Those people who were born once are going to die twice. Hallelujah. So Stephen is the first one recorded, went up in the New Covenant. Acts chapter 7, and let's speak about verse 55. Those who persecuted, how you handle them. Acts chapter 7, verse 55. And being full of the Holy Ghost, he looked steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God, Jesus standing at the right hand of God, and said, Behold, I've seen heaven open, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. And they cried with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord, and cast him out of the city and stone him and stone him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at the young man Pete, whose name was Saul. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God, saying, Lord, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, said, Lord, lay down this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. So Stephen being stoned to death, he forgave them. He said, Father, lay not this sin to their charge. I don't care who you are. Stephen was a man just like you. He have feelings. He hurt. And he's throwing rocks at him. If it's black people, if it's white people, if it's male people, the rocks hurt. And yet going through all that pain, like Jesus Christ on the cross, the nails in his hand and his feet, and all the things that they done for him, and crown of thorn in his head and everything, they buffeted him and everything, and that, going through all that pain, he said, Father, forgive them. They stoned him to death. Yeah, he said, look at that. Paul, put a good beating on him. Do thyself no harm, we're all here. What shall I do to be saved? What shall I do to be saved? Put a rope around your neck. But he said, no, call upon the name of Lord Jesus Christ. Look at Stephen. Look at it. Verse 59. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and cried with the Lord and said, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. Forgive them. Forgive them. I come into heaven. I don't know where these people are going. Forgive them. I'm going to be with you for all eternity. These people going to the other side for all eternity if they don't get it right. How Stephen dealt with it. Those that treated him wrong. Can you see that? How Peter dealt with it. Let's see James first before we go to Peter. How he dealt with it. James. Chapter 3. Is James in the Bible?
Yes, it is.
Just want to make sure we need B-I-B. Ellie James. Hallelujah. James chapter 3. How Stephen dealt with it. How James. Hallelujah. James chapter 3. Let's pick up the 13th verse. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works of meekness and wisdom. If there be bitter envy and strife in your heart, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descended not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envy and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But a wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, full of mercy, good fruits, without partiality, and without hypocrisy. The fruits of righteousness sow in peace to them that make peace. We have to read that again. Look at it. Where there is strife and confusion, there's every evil work. Go back to verse 13. Who is a wise man do with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation. That word conversation is lifestyle or manner of life. His works with meekness of wisdom. But if there are bitter envy and strife in your heart, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descended not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envy and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But a wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, full of mercy and of good fruits, without partiality, without hypocrisy, and the fruits of righteousness sow in peace to them that make peace. That environment. How Peter handled his own. 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3. 47 minutes after the second hour. And let's see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious word. 1 Peter chapter 3. Chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3. And Peter, when you look at the four Gospels, always Peter, James, and John. Peter, James, and John. First person he selected for his public ministry was Peter, and Peter has always taken the lead role. Peter. Who do men say, I am Peter? Well, some say you're Jeremiah in the Bible. Who do you say, I am Peter? Say, you're the Son of God. Peter, I didn't tell you that. Heavenly Father revealed that to you. Peter. Hallelujah. 1 Peter chapter 3, look at the 8th verse. Finally, be of all mind, having compassion one to another, love as brethren, be pitiful, and be courteous, not rendering evil for evil, nor railing for railing, but contrive by blessing, knowing that you dare unto a call and should inherit a blessing. You see why you cannot get the blessing? You see why you couldn't get blessed? You hate them, so I hate you. You're not going to get blessed. Let's go back up to that verse again. Go back to that verse again. Finally, be of one mind, having compassion one to another. Love as brethren. Be pitiful. Be courteous. Not rendering evil for evil, railing for railing, but contrive by blessing, knowing that you dare unto a call. You shall inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking guile. Let him eschew evil, do good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. For the eyes of the Lord is over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. Who is he that will harm you if you be followers of him that is good? Let's read some more. That is good. But if I be a sufferer for righteousness' sake, happy are you. Be not afraid of their terrors, neither be troubled. But sanctify the Lord your God in your heart, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asks you of a reason for your hope that is in you with the meekness of fear, having a good conscience, whereas they speak evil of you as an evildoer, that you may be ashamed and falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. For it is better if the will of God be so that you suffer for well doing than for evil doing. For Christ also once suffered for always for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, and being put to death in the flesh, but quickened in the spirit. Wow. We have to read some of those verses again. We want to go to John and hear what John say about it. We want to go what John say about it. Let's go actually and read parts of it and see what he's saying. Finally. And when we come towards the end, finally, my brethren, this is it. Find my brethren. Be of all one mind, having compassion one to another. Love the brethren, be pitiful, be courteous. Not rendering evil for evil, railing for rain, but contrive by blessing, knowing that you hereunto shall call, and you shall inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days. How many want to love life and see good days? You want to see good days and love life? Look at this. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking guile. Let him eschew evil, do good, seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord is over the righteous, and his ears are open unto the oppressed. But the face of the Lord is against him that do evil. Hallelujah. Let's see if we can run more. Let's see what John have to say about it. Big John chapter, little John, sorry. Little John, 1 John chapter 4. How you deal with them that persecute you? It's a straight line running through all of them. Don't render evil for evil, strife for strife, hate for hate. Don't do that. You get on their territory, you're going to reap what they sow. They sow that, they're going to reap that. 1 John chapter 4, and look at something here. 1 John chapter 4, God is still a good God. Hallelujah. 51 minutes after the second hour. And hear what God has to say to us in his holy, written, precious word. This is the Christian Family and Choice Radio 92.9 FM. Your life, your salvation, your choice. Telephone number, the church, 347-533-4271. At the studio, 347-663-8638. With persecution. John 1, John chapter 4. Pick it up at verse 9. They got 9 verse. In this is manifest the love of God towards us, because that God sent his only Son into the world that we might live through him. Hearing his love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be a propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so love us, we ought to love one another. No man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfect in us. Hereby know we that he dwell in us, and that he is in us, because he hath given us his Spirit. We have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever shall confess Jesus as the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he is in God. Look at verse 16. Look at the 16th verse. For we know and believe the love that God had to us. God is love. He that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Wow. Wow, man, that is something. That is something. Look at 15. Whosoever shall confess Jesus the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he in God. That is something. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love. He that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Wow. While I was cooking, I was eating.
Oh, yeah.
I had a wonderful time.
Oh, yeah.
With persecution, how to deal with it. Glory to God. Amen, amen, and amen. What do you think? Glory to God.
I really like, you know, the part when you say, you know, with persecution, how to deal with it. You know, most people don't know how to deal with it. They render evil for evil.
Oh, yeah.
Instead of showing love, you know, instead of forgiving and moving forward. It's like they hold on to it, you know, instead of understand with blessings come persecution.
Yeah.
And a lot of times they don't understand it. They go, well, I'm doing everything that's right. Why is this happening to me? But the persecution is coming.
Persecution.
Yes, with persecution. And what you have to learn to do is to love in spite of.
Yeah.
That's the key.
Yeah.
That is the key to everything. That's the key to the kingdom.
Yeah.
Because you have to love,
yeah.
You know, and you have to forgive.
Amen.
You know, that's the key.
You see, Nehemiah had a good plan. No matter what Sanballat, Tobias, and Geshem do, he keep building the wall.
Yes.
He just keep building. They come, they call him 4 times, 5 times. But on open it, they come, let's go and have a meeting. Let's have a conference. Let's, oh, he said, no, I'm doing a good work. I'm not stopping. Mm-hmm. Just keep on, just keep loving.
Yes.
You see, God, if you squeeze an orange, all you're going to get is orange juice. If you love, if God dwell in that last one already, God is in you.
Is
God
he?
Is love. So if they squeeze you, they punch you, they curse you, all come to his love. Mm-hmm. Stephen being stoned to death, Father, forgive them. Jesus on the cross, Father, forgive them. Lay not the sin to their child. You see, so what's in you going to come up?
Exactly.
From the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaking.
Mm-hmm. I know from experience myself, you know, and I thank God that, you know, that was inside of me to love, you know, because that's the key, because God is love. And most people don't understand a lot of time. It is not the person, it's the spirit behind it.
Yeah, because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness, wicked spirits in higher heaven places, the spirit behind it.
Yes.
You know, and then the person, if they're not saved and they yield to that spirit and think they're justified to hate you, or to curse you, or to treat you bad, that, but God showed how to do it. He gave us a roadmap how to do it. And we look at the picture come through, even what with Cain and Abel.
Yes.
He did right, he been blessed. The brother did wrong, he not been blessed, so he been cursed. And all that, and you come throughout. You see Joseph and his brethren, all the time you come throughout how he dealt with them. He could have, he got a wonderful opportunity being in that position of authority to deal with Potiphar and his wife and all of them. No, but he didn't do that. You see, that's not the way to do it. You see, and people treat us very, 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 very bad. We could come up here and give sermons about how people, but we just love and just keep moving on down because faith working by love. Once you understand that, you know, and sometimes God wants to move you to the next level, but he cannot. With you holding on to all that poison there, because he'd be aiding and abetting your spiritual crime. You have to drop that, forgive that person, because he gave you all this picture, his son, who knew no sin.
But
I got Stephen, I got Paul, and all these guys. Show them how they did.
You said something. Forgive the person and move forward.
And move forward.
Not hold on to it, and still, when you see the, anytime you see the person, it bothers you. That means you ain't forgive them.
No,
you didn't forgive.
You still need to. You need to go back to the oven and cook some
you
more.
You need to go back and cook. And not only that, then people hold on to things, and then they praying, and God not hearing your prayer because you got to fix that over there.
You
cannot have an issue with your brother and don't forgive, because persecution is coming.
Yeah, because he said, if you have aught against any, leave your at the altar, go settle that first, and then come back. Leave it there, and then come back. Leave it at the altar, and then go deal with that, and come back. We want to give those that are viewing and listening and communicate with this station opportunity to receive Jesus the Lord and Savior. He says, not my wish that any should perish. He doesn't want anybody going to hell. Hell was not made for you, but for the devil and his angel. You don't have to go to hell. All you have to do is to say yes. You don't have to fall out any form, quit your job, leave your husband and wife, abandon your kids, give up your apartment, change your name, join the church, fall out some forms. No such stuff. All you say, fall under the master's sword. Who are thou, Lord? I'm Jesus. What will thou have me to do? Say, go into the city, I'll tell you what thou oughtest to do. And that's all he said, as bad as he was working for the kingdom of God. And Saul mean destroyed. With that name, he got saved. Later on, they changed it to Paul. So all you have to do is to say it. If you're already saved, we wanted to stand proxy for somebody who's not saved. If you're not saved, then stand for yourself. Repeat these words, I mean, from the bottom of your heart. Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
You said in your holy word.
You said in your holy word.
Whosoever come to me.
Who should ever come to me.
I'll in no way cast out.
I will no way cast out.
But I'll take them in.
But I'll take them in.
So I come to you.
So I come to you.
You didn't cast me out.
You didn't cast me out.
But you took me in.
But you took me in.
And I thank you.
And I thank you.
Romans 10.
Romans 10.
Verse 13.
Verse 13.
Whosoever call upon the name of the Lord.
Who should ever call upon the name of the Lord.
Shall be saved.
Shall be saved.
So I call upon your name.
So I call upon your name.
So I'm now saved.
So I'm now saved.
Romans 10.
Romans 10.
Verses 9 and 10.
Verses 9 and 10.
With the mouth confession is made unto salvation.
With the mouth confession is made unto salvation.
But with the heart man believe it unto righteousness.
But with the heart man believe it unto righteousness.
So I confess with my mouth.
So I confess with my mouth.
The Lord Jesus.
The Lord Jesus.
That he died.
That he died.
Went to hell.
Went to hell.
Spent 3 days.
Spent 3 days.
And 3 nights.
And 3 nights.
Just for me.
Just for me.
Because I confessed that with my mouth.
Because I confessed that with my mouth.
And I believe that in my heart.
And I believe that in my heart.
I'm now saved.
I'm now saved. saved.
I now become, the righteousness, of God, in Christ. Second Corinthians.
5:21. Jesus.
You represent me in heaven.
You represent me in heaven.
And I will. Represent you on earth. Jesus.
I
thank you.
For
what you did for me.
On
Calvary. Shedding your blood. To redeem me. From the curse of the law. Spiritual death. Poverty.
And
sickness.
Satan.
You no longer my Lord.
Jesus Christ.
Is my Lord. And my Savior. I'll live for him. I'll serve him.
I'll study his words.
I'll be a good example. For all to see. And I thank you. In your name I pray.
Amen.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. If you receive Christ as Lord and Savior, the Bible says that Christianity is not passive but active. You need to do something about it, but don't give place to the devil. When an unclean spirit has gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places seeking rest, he find none, he's coming back. Come back and find the house empty, sweep and garnish, you're going to get seven more, made more wicked himself. Come back to dwell in your last, it is worse than your first. You need to do something. Start reading your Bible right away. I want to suggest you start with the Gospel according to John. He speaks about love more than the others. All of them speak about love, of course, but he mentioned the word love more than all the others. About over 50 times in the Gospel, over 50 times in the Epistle. So he's the love apostle. So start with the first chapter, read it in the morning, read that same chapter again at lunchtime, again at bedtime. Take your time and read it. Don't try to read the whole Bible in one day. Just take your time and chew on it. Tomorrow read chapter 2, then chapter 3, and so on. Go on. As you come towards the end, God's going to read you. Every day you feed your spirit as you feed your body. Ask God to lead you to a church that will feed you spiritually. Don't go to church because your friend's going there, because everybody from the same country, the same district you're from. That's not the reason to go to church. Find out something about it. Ask God to lead you. He'll lead you where he wants you to go. So where your friends and they go, maybe good for them. Not that it's a bad church where your friend's going, but that may not be good for you. It's like you go to the doctor. Some people need to see a plasmatologist. Some need to see a dermatologist. Some need to see a gynecologist. Some need to see the pediatrician for the children or whatever it is. But everybody don't need the same doctor. So whatever might be good for your friends may not be good for you. So ask him to lead you. By spirit, when he leads you there, then you go there and you submit to that. When he leads you there, every church you go to have problem because there are people, more problems. So don't think because God tells you to go there, everything will be smooth as glass, no such thing. Because everybody don't see things the same way. Everybody's not in fifth grade spiritually. Some people in first grade, some in second grade, some in third grade spiritually. So you go there, God send you there to be a blessing to them. Don't curse the dark, but light a candle and God gonna bless you. Amen. Father, we thank you for this time that you have given us, the opportunities and privileges you've given us. Thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, who make all this possible. We give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory, yes, because Lord, all belong to you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Good night.
You have been listening to Pastor Randolph Ferdinand, teachings from the Word. To get a copy of this teaching or any of the other series, call 347-533-4271. 347-533-4271. Or visit the Christian Community Center at 326 Junior Street in Brooklyn. That is 326 Junior Street in Brooklyn. Sunday worship 9:30, 10:30, and 12:30. Bible study 6:30 p.m. on Monday nights. Like us on Facebook or YouTube at H2C3 Ministry. H2C3 Ministry. Go for the Word. I'm
In Christ Jesus. It is my pleasure to invite you to part two, Women Endowed with Power Conference, taking place at Helping Hands Christian Community Center. We are located at 326 Julia Street between Sutter and Blake. Taking place on July 25th, July 26th at 6 o'clock in the evening. Our speakers are Evangelist Heather Lashley, Prophetess Pauline McKnight, and yours truly, Pastor Lillian Ferdinand. Women, the location once again is 326 Julius. The date is Friday, July 25th, Saturday, July 26th. And I am expecting to see you there because you need to be there. Once again, Women Endowed with Power, you need to be there.
I'm walking miracles, I live a life of favor, cause I know.
It cannot be broken. studio. Everything a double double. Promotion double double. Your money double double. Your business double double. Your health double double. Your children double double. Your anointing double double. Somebody scream! Hallelujah! In the morning when I wake up, I will sing my praise unto you, my Lord. I will shout, I will dance to you. You have given me health forever, ever. Your money double double. Your anointing double double. Come on now. Your health go double double. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Oshé Obama. Clap your hands, 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 clap your hands. Somebody scream me down. Take it as high as you can. Come on, double, 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 double. Hey, my God is good to you. Your deliverance double double. You're worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. He's a worthy God. You are worthy, Lord. Hey, make your Holy Ghost crazy noise in the house. Come on, put your hands together.
Hey, my God is good.
Hey, my God
double double, oh.
Not double double.
Everything a double double, oh.
Not double double.
Promotion double double, oh.
Not double double.
Your money double double, oh.
Not double double.
Your house a double double, oh.
Not double double.
Your cars a double double, oh. Somebody scream! When I wake up, I will sing my praise unto you, my Lord. I will shout, I will dance to you. You have been my help forever, ever. Hey, my God is good, oh. Double, come on. Hey, your God is good, oh.
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 Hey, your God is good, oh. Mata emote, mama, hey, let me hear you shout. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Let's go. Simbalo no train the kulumba no say what of it.
Same wambo yo.
All right, let's do it like this. Same wambo yo. Say
same wambo yo.
Come on, let's do it like this. Come on.
Same wambo yo.
Come on, let's do it like this. Come on.
Same wambo yo.
Everybody, come on. Let's do it like this. Come on.
Same wambo yo.
Come on, Sande Wambo yo,
Sande Wambo yo.
Come on, Sande Wambo yo,
Sande Wambo yo.
What's that? Sande Wambo yo,
Sande Wambo yo.
Are you ready? Now, let's go. This here, kale kale.
Ah, Sande Wambo yo.
Come on, what's that?
Ah, Sande Wambo yo.
Turn around.
Ah, Sande Wambo yo.
Here, kale kale.
Ah.
This way. Sukatin,
Yeah. Are you ready tonight?
Come on.
Hallelujah. I serve a very big God. Oh,
hallelujah.
Are you ready tonight? Come on, let's sing. Oh, hallelujah. I serve a very big God.
Oh,
listen. My God, you be big.
Oh, 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 oh.
My God, you find.
Oh, 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 oh.
My God, you kind.
Oh,
to my right, when I look to my friend, when I go to my front, when I go to my back, come on,
hey.
When I go to my right, when I go to my left, when I go to my front, hey, when I go to my back,
say,
when I go to my right, when I go to my left, when I go to my front, when I go to my right,
let me hear you scream.
Hallelujah, I serve a very big God. Oh,
hallelujah,
oh my God. Oh, hallelujah, I serve a very big God. Oh,
hey,
all right. Oh, hallelujah, I can't go find a night. Shall follow me all of the days.
Oh, well,
let me hear you say,
goodness and mercy.
Are you ready tonight? Are you ready tonight? San Jolama Yahweh Nabito San Jolama.
San Jolama.
San Jolama Yahweh Nabito San Jolama.
San Jolama.
Yembelama Yahweh Nabito Yembelama.
San Jolama.
Yembelama Yahweh Nabito San Jolama.
See
you shake your body right now. Come on, shake your body, shake your body, shake your body, shake. Praise the Lord with your dance. Shake your body, shake your body, shake your body, shake your body. Are you ready to celebrate Bloemfontein? Come on, let's go. Celebrate, 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 celebrate. Let me hear you scream. The way, the way, the way, the way, yes, the way, the way, the way, the way, the way, yes, the way, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus. All right, let me show you something now. Are you ready to dance to the Lord? The Bible says, praise the Lord with a dance. All right, I'm going to teach you a little dancing style. Are you ready, Bloemfontein? When I say teremoka, teremoka, you go down, all right? When I say banda, you come up, all right? Can I try it with you, brother? All right, one of those, two, go. Say, teremoka, 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 banda, 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 teremoka, again, come on. Teremoka, 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 banda, 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 come on, come on. Yahweh Nanga, Yahweh Nabito,
Sancho Lama,
Yembe Lama, Yahweh Nabito, Yembe Lama, Sancho Lama, Yahweh Nabito,
Sancho Lama,
Yembe Lama, Yahweh Nabito, Yembe
Lama.
Celebrate, come on, celebrate, come on, celebrate, 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 celebrate. Let me hear you scream. All right now, come on this way. Joyous celebration.
Joyous, hey! Celebration.
Joyous celebration.
Joyous
celebration. We're here to pray. Come on, put us aside. Oh, oh, oh. Hey, we're here to praise.
Now in Zimbabwe when we say uko uko, we mean over there. That is where the blessings are. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. If you're ready to say over there with me, say uko uko. Uko 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 uko uko. Listen here. There's a saying we say that we use when we crush demons. We say rikitama demon. Rikitama demon meaning crush the demon. Are you ready to crush the demon? Are you ready to crush the demon? Are you ready? Are you ready? Rikitama demon. Rikitama demon. When I say Batam Sana, you hold your waist like this. When I say Tenderera, you Tenderera, 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 Tenderera. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Batam Soro, Batam Sana, Batam Soro, Batam Sana, Batam Soro, Batam Sana, Batam Soro, Batam Sana, Tenderera, 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 Tenderera. Batam Soro, Batam Sana, Batam Soro, Batam Sana, Batam Soro, Batam Sana, Batam Soro, Batam Sana, Tenderera, 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 Tenderera.
as we strive for perfection in Christ Jesus. It is my pleasure to invite you to part two, Women Endowed with Power Conference, taking place at Helping Hands Christian Community Center. We are located at 326 Julius Street between Sutter and Blake. Taking place on July 25th, July 26th at 6 o'clock in the evening. Our speakers are Evangelist Heather Lashley, Prophetess Pauline McKnight, and yours truly, Pastor Lillian Ferdinand. Women, the location once again is 326 Julius. The date is Friday, July 25th. Saturday, July 26th, and I am expecting to see you there because you need to be there. Once again, Women Endowed with Power, you need to be there.
Chosen generation, called for to show His excellence.
All I require for life,
all I require for life, God has given me, and I know who I am.
We are a chosen generation.
We are a chosen generation.
All I require
for life, God has given me, and I
is my desire to all One, two.